name is not on the program, so let me introduce myself. I'm Michael Dash from the French department, not far from here at NYU. And I've been asked to essentially present Abdourahman, who I've known for a while. And instead of having just a lecture, we'll have a conversation, in fact, on various topics. So I thought, first of all, I should introduce Abdourahman, who's been introduced already just a couple hours ago. First of all, to tell you he's from Djibouti, and that in his career, I'll just read essentially from Wikipedia. He worked as an English teacher, but there's something that Wikipedia does not have, which is really what this whole conversation is going to be about. He worked as an English teacher in Caen, France, where he lived for most of the time since 1985. He was awarded several honors, including the Stefan George Prize 2006 award, Heine Universita, the Grand Prix Littéraire de l'Afrique Noire in 1996, and the Prix Biennale Mandat pour la Liberté offered by Pen France. He was chosen among the 50 writers of the future by the French magazine Lire. In 2006 to 2007, Waberi lived in Berlin as a guest of the DAAD. In 2007, he was a Donald and Susan Newhouse Center Humanities Fellow at Wellesley College. His work is translated into more than 10 languages. In 2007, Waberi participated in the National Stock Exchange of Visions project. In 2010, he was a William P. Podlick Distinguished Fellow and Visiting Professor at Claremont McKenna College, California, and a Villa Medici Fellow in Roma, Italy. In May and June 2012, he was a visiting professor at the University of Innsbruck, Austria. His novel Transit was a finalist for the Best Translated Book Award in 2013, and he teaches now French and Francophone studies and creative writing at George Washington University, Washington, D.C. That's Wikipedia. How do I know Abdourahman Waberi? It's not here. I think it was in 1999. I was asked in 1999 to translate a short story by someone I'd never met. And we're going to read part of that short story at the beginning. And I was struck by the fact that, first of all, this was someone from Djibouti. I'd never read anything coming from Djibouti either. But the absolute originality of the short story. It was called The Gallery of the Insane, La Galerie des Fous. And published in this collection called Excité. This short story may have been one of the first things that I in English from you that appeared in English, right? Was actually shortlisted, in the shortlist, for the Michael Caine Award for the best short story in Africa. So we'll read a piece of this story for you. Now this, the collection actually, I think is very interesting. It's called Excité, with a pun on excited and coming out of cities, and was put together by a woman called Georgia de Chambéry in 1999. And in her introduction, I think she captures a whole lot of what I think is really sort of really stunning in the work of Abdourahman. She says, "France is going through a period of apocalyptic change and growth, reflected in the cultural explosion of the last two decades. It is gradually beginning to accept rather than deny that it is a cultural mosaic of attitudes, faiths, languages, and traditions, and to recognize the voice and power of its suburbs and inner cities. Herein lies its strength and its future. French society is on the move. Underground club culture has gone global as the melodies of Air, Daft Punk, and MC Solar permeate the world. The 98 World Cup victory established it as a major footballing superpower. Cult movies such as Betty Blue and La Haine set precedents for international filmmakers, and its great theorists are toppling, from their pedestals. Excité, the collection, captures the radical creative spirit of the 80s and 90s, driving France into the millennium and beyond." And the story from Abdourahman, she says, "Abdourahman Waberi is the poetic lance of the younger post-colonial writers whose roots stretch back to the African continent." And in case you think this was some kind of little provincial piece of work, who else is in this collection? Well, Marie Desplechin, Virginie Despentes, Michel Welbeck, Matthew Kasovitz, among others. And Abdourahman's short story is in there. So what we thought we should do is for you to hear Abdourahman in French, hear his voice. You'll read two or so pages, and I'll read the English afterwards, which is my translation, which almost got him the Michael K. Prize, which is not in Wikipedia. Anyway, so you go ahead, Abdourahman.
Okay, I will say a word of welcoming to each and everyone, because this is what I am used to, and this is how I was also educated. My grandmother used to say, you can say ever hello to a tree. And it doesn't mean you are trees, it means that every human being that you encounter, be them human beings, but also be them animals or even minerals, you have to acknowledge them. You know, it's a really deep nomadic way of just saying, hello, this is life going on for me. And just I want to say, because there are many things we are in this excited city called and New York, so there's many things you could have done and you came, so thank you. I just want same stroke say thank you to Kate, who have done everything in organizing. I want to say thank you to NYU and NYU Dubai, NYU Abu Dhabi, sorry. someone called actually, this name is missing, but I will find afterwards. And I want to thank to my friend Michael, who was, as he said, the first translator I had. And at that time, I know because I was a fan of Edouard Glissant, so I knew that he was the mediator and translator of Edouard Glissant. So this person, when she was putting together this anthology, and she said, your piece will be translated by Michael Dash. I said, oh, yeah. And he said that I was at that time a young writer. I'm now aging. So this was actually 16 years ago, about, 2000.
Yeah.
So I'm not anymore a so young writer. But anyhow, thank you. And I will read a piece of Pays sans ombre, La Galerie des Fous, which is the first story. Un ciel presque blanc. À force d'être bleu, un quartier de Djibouti dans la ville basse. Une maison en bois, comme toutes les autres, avec un toit en aluminium. Sur la toiture sale et trouée, travaillée tant par la nature, je recommence. Sur la toiture sale et trouée, travaillée tant par la rouille que par l'usure, ça et là, les objets les plus inattendus se côtoient et se renvoient d'étranges échos. Un ballon crevé et recroquevillé par la chaleur, une vieille roue de vélo ratatinée, un chapeau de paille usé, un soulier éculé, un chiffon, quelques pauvres clous. Dans un coin ombreux de la véranda, adossé à la cloison mitoyenne, un homme plus vieux que jeune est assis sur une nappe de raffia. Devant lui, une petite table basse et bancale, sur laquelle sont posées côte à côte une petite glacière rouge pour garder l'eau fraîche, une thermos pour le thé chaud et fortement épicé, un verre et une tasse. Juste sous le robinet de la glacière, enveloppé dans un chiffon constamment humide, le kat, la plante de toutes les convoitises dans cette partie du monde, la plante magique, maléfique. Le kat se présente sous forme de brindille, retenus ensemble par une fibre en couleur de liège provenant d'une feuille de bananier. Cet homme, aux yeux mi-clos de ceux qui ont veillé la nuitée, c'est mon père. Awale, brut, comme on dit chez nous, avec une pointe de fierté. À vrai dire, il ne broute pas. Il mâche son cadre comme on chique du tabac, ou on mâche du chewing-gum. Et tous les quarts d'heure, à peu près, il boit une gorgée d'eau fraîche, puis des thés chauds. Le cadre donne soif. Les quatre donnent des fourmis dans les jambes. Mon père change de position toutes les demi-heures. Après le côté droit, son préféré, il s'accoude sur le côté gauche. Il procède toujours de la même manière. Toujours. Les quatre me rythment la vie des gens dans ces foutus pays. 104 points de vue, points de vie. De 13h à 20h, les quatre tiennent les hommes et les femmes en vie. Sans lui, que faire, comment vivre? Celle, la voix échelée du muezzin, vient troubler pour quelques-uns ces rituels fort bien assimilés. Dans un monde à la dérive, les hommes s'agrippent à la chose la plus fragile qui soit. les brindilles d'un arbuste éthiopien. Cette plante les a guéris en retour. Le kat, c'est le poison et son antidote. Autrement dit, l'incarcération perpétuelle. Les incendies les plus meurtriers se produisent toujours l'après-midi, quand léthargiques, hommes et femmes, enfants et bêtes, aspirent à la rêverie. Quelques ruelles boueuses plus loin, une maisonnette n'en finit pas de se consumer. Les pompiers se font attendre à tel des messies, comme à l'accoutumée. Peut-être qu'ils ne viendront jamais. Qu'importe. On dit qu'ils ne savent pas où donner de la tête. La semaine dernière, une nonagénaire névoprate a péri épuisée, étouffée sous les décombres. Une poignée de cendres semblait indiquer tout ce qui restait de la vieille. Des heures plus tard, quand l'incendie fut vaincu par les voisinages impassibles. Le feu, prométhée malicieux, mâche superbement le travail pour les agents de l'urbanisme. Au vu au sud de tout le monde, le feu dans sa danse lunatique besogne en traçant des ruelles, zigzagant dans la ville basse, emportant tout sur son passage, tel un inquérant, et ne laissant que des pieux rabougris de couleur anthracite. Plus récemment, devant les victimes impuissantes, un haut responsable de l'urbanisme a tenu ses discours. Le feu ne fait pas des cadeaux, mais reconnaissez qu'on a les incendies qu'on mérite. Remarquez, nous ne déplorons jamais des dégâts causés par quelques pyromanes dans la vraie ville. Dans cette partie de la ville, le feu a carte blanche. Hésitante comme un frêle esquive, la vie sourd du ventre creux d'une fillette. Cette femme enfant, au visage fort émacié, donne la béquille à un enfant tout aussi souffreteux. Qui est la mère? Qui est le rejetant? Pendant ce temps, non loin de là, mon père est assis sur une natte d'érafia, adossé à la cloison mitoyenne comme à son habitude, il broute machinalement. Dehors, c'est la raffue. Le vent chaud fige les visages à tel point qu'on dirait des masques insensibles. Le rue se vide de l'air passant. La vie se fait plus lente, plus fluide. Il n'y aura plus personne dans les ruelles. Le vacarme aura disparu. L'heure fantôme approche à pas de loup. Le cat installe son emprise sur la ville. En attendant la zombification, plus rien ne compte. Le monde extérieur a cessé d'exister. C'est l'air fantôme.
Voilà, traduction. There's a translation. So the story was called The Gallery of the Insane. A sky so blue, it is almost white. An area of the poor quarter of Djibouti. A wooden house, just like the rest, with an aluminium roof. On the filthy roof, riddled with holes, eaten away as much by rust, humidity reigns supreme, as by wear and tear. Here and there, the most surprising objects are juxtaposed and reverberate with strange echoes. A burst ball shriveled by the heat, an old shattered bicycle wheel, a dilapidated straw hat, a worn-out shoe, a rag, a few wretched nails. In a shady corner of the veranda, back against the partition, an elderly man is seated on a raffia mat. Before him, a low rickety table on which are placed side by side a little red ice jug for keeping water cool, a thermos for tea, which is hot and fragrant with spices, cinnamon, cloves, cardamom, and ginger, a glass and a cup. Right under the spout of the ice jug, wrapped in cloth, kept constantly wet, cat, the most desirable plant in this corner of the world, the magic plant, one that brings misfortune. Cat looks like twigs held together by a cork-colored strand from a banana leaf. This man with the half-closed eyes of someone who has stayed up all night is my father. Awale ruminates, as we say, with great pride. If the truth be told, he does not ruminate. He chews his cat the way you chew tobacco, or chewing gum for that matter. And every 15 minutes or so, he drinks a mouthful of cold water, then some hot tea. Cat makes you thirsty. Cat gives you pins and needles in your legs. My father changes position every half hour. After leaning on his right side, the one he prefers, he leans to the left. It is always the same routine. Always. People's lives follow the rhythm of cat in this damned country. Without cat, life has no point. From 1 p.m. to 8 p.m., cat keeps men and women alive. Without it, what does one do? How does one live? Only the solitary voice of the muezzin manages to disturb, for a few, this deeply ingrained ritual. In a world set apart, people cling to the most fragile thing imaginable, the sprigs of an Ethiopian shrub. This plant repays them with an ability to endure. Cat is poison and its antidote. In other words, life imprisonment. The most deadly fires occur on afternoons when, in a state of lethargy, men, women, children, and animals yearn to get lost in a world of dreams. A few muddy lanes away, a tiny house is being consumed by flames. The firemen oblige everyone to wait as if they were the Messiah. Just like always, what does it matter? It is said they no longer know which way to turn. Last week, a 90-year-old mentally ill woman died exhausted, suffocated under the ruins. A handful of ashes seemed to indicate all that remained of her when the fire was finally quelled by impassive neighbors. Fire, that malevolent Prometheus, does the job of the town planning people beautifully. Within public view, fire is in a crazy dance, toils at tracing alleyways that zigzag through the poor quarter, sweeping everything in its path like the woeful river Acheron, leaving behind nothing but gnarled, stunted stumps, slate black in color. Most recently, in front of some powerless victims, a leading town planning official uttered a dull pronouncement. Fire spares no one, but we should recognize that we only get the fires we deserve. You may have noticed that we never even lament the damage caused by some pyromaniac in the heart of town. In our part of the town, fire is free to act at will. Hesitant like some tiny craft, life struggles in the hollow belly of a little girl. A girl child with an emaciated face feeds a child which is just as half-starved, which is the mother, which is the offspring. In the meantime, a small distance away, my father is seated on his raffia mat. Back against the partition as usual, he chews away instinctively. There's a racket outside. The hot wind stiffens people's faces in a mask-like immobility. The roads empty of passers-by, life slows down, liquefies. No longer will there be anyone in the lanes. The hustle and bustle will evaporate. The bewitching hour approaches stealthily. Cat takes its hold over the town. Nothing else counts as zombification sets in. The outside world has ceased to exist. It is the bewitching hour. So that's it. So this is my introduction to Abdourahman Waberi. And I thought this was an amazing short story writer. And my first question, in fact, will be about the short story. That is, I think that in reading this, you had all that that sort of stripped down, suggestive, very evocative prose that you find in the best short stories, or some of the best short stories. Is this something that, where did this come from? Is this something that you had seen before? Is it, could you give us some explanation of the secret?
Yeah, actually, this is the best way to begin with a kind of introduction to my work and my world. So the hazard, or maybe the chances that we began with this story is a good starter, is a good point of departure. Actually, when I was writing, this is my first piece ever published. And I quite remember vividly even the first sentence of my work, un ciel presque blanc à force d'être bleu, un quartier de Djibouti dans la ville basse. So it just began, you know, I just have this image of a blue, a sky so blue that is almost white. And then you go on and you say, where are you writing from? What is your world? As we saying that in my previous talk. And then you're giving birth to a world, kind of, right? And so at that time I was in Normandy, I was 26 years old, I guess. And I wanted to write something about Djibouti. I don't know how. I just knew that I was not, because I was also a student, you know, I have this academic education. So I just knew that I didn't want to write a short story à la Maupassant, you know? I was in Normandy at that time, so it was topical and relevant. So the traditional, at least in the French world or Francophone world, of what we call a short story is different from in this country even. The short story that you have in this country by Cheever, or you know, this kind of that you can read in the New Yorker, that was the thing that I was wanted to write. I didn't want to write a short story traditionnel where you have a surprising suspense at the end, with a bit of fantastic, with a flow Maupassant. So I knew that I didn't want to write a short story à la Maupassant. So having said that, what do you do next? I also have an interest because of where I come from and because of my history, kind of. I have a deep interest in politics, you know, what we might call social commentary. Mm-hmm. So what I wanted is to write social commentary, or what we call editorial in French, you know, op-ed. Op-ed kind of driven story plus an interest in poetry. That was my two rails. You know, I knew that I want to write in a poetry, my language is poetical, it's poetical. So it's evocative, you know. And I was also writing from Djibouti, from this shanty town, from this what I call periphery of the periphery, giving voice to the voiceless, etc., etc. So I just mixed the two. And what came out is a cluster of vignettes, if you will, you know, this high kind of, you know, we're going from, there is no kind of, you know, construction or plot. So you're going from one place to another place to another place. The whole vignette are put together by a very minimum dramatic plot, you know. So this is La Galerie des Fous. It's La Galerie des Fous, the Gallery of the Insane. It's a tableau. You have different tableaux of different crazy people, if you will. Mm-hmm. And so it's my way of giving a birth to my shanty town. It's a kind of opera, you know, opera. And it's just giving voice to a vignette and from going from one place to another. So the whole point is how you put together and how you knit together. It's what I call la marqueterie. So for me, the whole business of writing is putting it together. It's, you know, puzzling together, putting together the puzzles, so that you have a line, a dramatic line, and then you can have variations on the theme, or you can have poetry, and you can change from, the tone can change from a tone that can be, I don't know, dramatical, and you can go to a poetical, and then evocative, and so on and so forth. So I don't have a theory, but I knew I didn't want to write à la Maupassant. I knew I have to have language and poetry interest, and I knew that I have to have social commentary. So I put together, and the lucky thing is that someone published it and said, okay, yeah, I will continue. And then this is the first book I published ever. This is 1994. It became the first fiction short story published by a Djiboutian. So I was using the same technique, so I will go, because this is 13 short stories, sometimes very short, really like on op-ed. 3 pages, 5 pages. Mm-hmm. So I found that this, I have not done the business, so I go to another one that was called Cahier Nomade, the Nomadic Notebook. And so for those short stories, I have 13, 17 and 13. And still I thought that the fresco was not done, so I have done another novel that is called Balbala. So by the time I have a trilogy, mm-hmm. 3 books in a row, fiction row, first time also that a Djiboutian wrote 3 books, fiction books in the same breath. Mm-hmm. So I have done my trilogy, what I call my bankal trilogy. Bankal, how do you say?
Shaky.
Shaky, yeah. Shaky trilogy, mm-hmm. because you have two books of short story and one novel. And from then I just say, well, I have my fresco, so I can be a serious Djiboutian guy representing Djibouti here and there. So anyhow, but this is really funny that we began with the first short story that you have been translated, and that I and that allows me to go to, let's say, places like Zimbabwe, because when I was on the Kane Prize, I went to Zimbabwe. So this is my coming to my birth certificate. Very good, yeah. My birth certificate.
But I must admit, when I read it first, of course, as you said, it's your very first short story. I said to myself, but this is Raymond Carver. This is not your traditional French mm-hmm. style. And I think Georgia, who put this together, must have felt the same way, because mm-hmm. as I said before, he's keeping company mm-hmm. with Welbeck, Kassovitz, yeah. and so on. So people didn't see this as particularly Djiboutian, mm-hmm. nor African, nor Francophone. They just saw this as modern, mm-hmm. as cutting-edge modern. And I think that instincts are absolutely right, because in translating the story, in fact, in reading, rereading my translation, you know, there's a kind of clipped, stripped-down quality in the way in which you put together, like, objects and sort of instance that in a sense really does bridge poetry and journalism, because it's concrete, and the more concrete it gets, the more poetic it gets. So in a sense, you arrived at a style as much as anything else. I mean, mm-hmm. so it wasn't just that you became the first Djiboutian mm-hmm. writer.
That is good for me to, I know, to have this fuel.
Yeah, so what do you think about this question of style? Because I don't think everyone from Djibouti is going to write like this.
No, no, definitely, yeah. Mm. I was not aware, you know. For me, the heartbreaking part of the story is that, as I said, I was putting la marqueterie, the pieces together. So sometimes, because I have read in kilometres, so my way of writing, just write it, and I say writing au kilomètre, you know, by the kilometre. And then the whole point is when you have to get aside or put aside a piece and just say this piece I have said already, or is not fitting because it's less poetic or less weak or more weak and so on and so forth. So the whole thing for me is to take the, as I say, the red pen and then just say this piece I will take, get rid of this one I will not want, this one I will not want. So then as a good cook, you say, so these are the pieces that I want to keep it, right? And then the whole thing is how to put, which will I don't know, which piece will be the first one, which will be the leading refrain, or you know, so that is the difficult question. And sometimes the only thing that I find is to rely on my guts. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I just read out loud, you know, I voice, Flaubert used to say le gueuloir, so I just voice out and say it, like, you know, outspoken poetry, and just say, okay, this is resounding, so I will keep this one. So there is, you know, it's, I don't have a rule still now. I know something, because I also, and I guess this has to be with the Francophonie, or maybe the fact that I'm not a native speaker of French. For example, now, as I said, I'm getting old, but I was quite sure when I was young, let's say some years ago, when I found a new word, a new term. For example, I will find, I don't know, Presqu'île, or a new word, Barzac, or I don't know. I can find some words in books of you know, botanic or botanic books or yeah. You know, science books, and I say, oh gosh, I haven't used this one, you know. Mm-hmm. So I have a sensitive quality or hearing quality, and say, this word sounds so poetic, or I don't know, so beautiful, or it can be a technical word, but I know that I have not used that one yet. And you know, it's a friend, you know, and I keep this one, I brush it, you know, I paint it, and I put it in some place in my, and say, I will use you someday. And I'm not kidding. Sometimes I just make a whole story because I want to use this word. And I say, Barzak, you know, Barzak is a word that has come from Islamic philosophy also. It's the limbo, you know, the in-between area between hell and, I don't know, between real and unreal, you know. So I just say Barzak, I love this word. I just say I will use Barzak, and I will maybe have a story from me called Barzac, and then some people would just say, why this is written this way? No, I just wanted to use this word and to put this, you know, word in full light, kind of. So I have this game, this sensitive, and I guess if I were born French, if I were, I don't know, Michel Houellebecq, maybe the word of Barzac will, that's why Michel Houellebecq is so naturalistic. Isn't he? Mm-hmm. He doesn't have this, he's using his language differently, let's say. But he doesn't have this, you know, I don't know, fetishist quality of the sound, of the word, of right. the term in French. And maybe because I come from Somali culture, I just, it's more a sonic quality, oral quality, than what it means sometimes, you know. Yeah. I don't know if it makes sense.
Yeah, no, but in fact, it's an interesting perspective, because, you know, one of the things that we tend to do with, especially writers who are non-European, mm-hmm. is that we seem to see them always as kind of representatives of their community, yeah. mm-hmm. you know, and the question of belonging and native land and so on comes up. But one of the things that's really striking is that estrangement is very much part of what they're all about and mm-hmm. their identity. And in this case, I find the way you speak about language and the French language, I mean, in fact, even to call you a French language writer mm-hmm. seems to be quite wrong, mm-hmm. Because it's, in a sense, your estrangement from French which allows you to write mm-hmm. this particular mm-hmm. kind of French. Because in some ways, this works so well in English, so that it begins now to kind of become a kind of multilingual mm-hmm. drifting language. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I don't know what you think about that, the extent to which this question of division and estrangement, and in fact, the horrible word alienation, in fact, turns out to be a positive thing for some writers.
I definitely think so, yeah. You know, and you said that you write saying that we always want to writer from the global south, let's say this way, be representative of their countries and voice out the voiceless, as Césaire was saying. It's true, and actually it's true on a political level, on individual level. I say that I need that as a to motivate myself and say, you know, I was always making fun of myself. Just to another anecdote, I went to Italy where I was translating, and I said to this Italian journalist, and he said, yeah, you are the first Djibouti, and so on, so yes, I want to be the Dante of Djibouti. So for me, my own humor, the whole tension was Dante and Djibouti, you know, the big of the small, you know. But if you don't keep the tension, because I was mocking myself somehow, and say, I want to be the Dante of Djibouti, because they were also pronouncing Djibouti this differently. But then if you get rid of the tension and you put that directly, you know, mm-hmm. it sounds egotistic, you know. This is not my personality. I say, no, anyhow. Then I say, okay, why? I well deserved. I want to play the funny guy, so I got the slap. Okay, good for me. But you know, I was playing with this tension. So I guess that we need, on a personal level, on individual level, on a political level, on an activism kind of level. But when we're writing, I guess this is not the most relevant issue. The most relevant issue is the struggle with language, and language is that we are. This estrangement exists even in your own native language. Mm-hmm. Edouard Glissant was saying that nous n'écrivons pas, nous écrivons en présence des autres langues. We write in the presence of every other language, and I guess it's true in the 17th centuries, or maybe if you are French, you were maybe living only in Franco-centric world where you don't have anything else. But nowadays, I guess you live in the presence of the other languages, even when you don't speak. I mean by that, you are aware mm-hmm. that there are different ways of being artistically valuable. You know that German people write, Indonesian people write, and Iraqi writes also. So you have this, you cannot forget the big picture. You can sometimes if you go back to some provincialistic French writing, right. But when we are the lucky, because we came from the outside, so we knew that we were writing in the presence of the other languages. But we also finding our home in a big sometimes patronesque language, which is French, and we trying to find our small niche within this big canvas. So I guess we were lucky because we were. We were, of course, more cosmopolitan than those who claim that they were cosmopolitan. But that's another story.
Yeah. Yes, in fact, I think that's absolutely wonderful. Like, reference to Glissant, because he says you must never write your own language in a monolingual way. Uh-huh. So always write it in a multilingual way. Let's change a little bit to something that I also find fascinating. There's nothing that destroys literature so much as teaching it. I've taught literature for many, many years, yeah. And you have to really fight to keep your interest in literature separate from the question of teaching it and breaking it down and that kind of thing. You teach literature now, and I'd love to hear how you manage that balancing act between remaining a writer and teaching writing.
I can understand what you say, because I teach if I were teaching grad school and teaching directing PhDs, I guess I will be more in an unpleasant space. But I teach with the undergrads, and I really love interacting and being among them. And because it's also a question of rationality. Mm-hmm. I do believe this is my strategy, but I mean this is my philosophy. By strategy, I don't mean just, I mean seriously. Because I do believe in what we call the banquet, the communion. Mm-hmm. I do believe philosophically that if I don't have an amount of connection, I'm not in a good shape. For example, when I was in Berlin or in Villa Medicisi in Roma, I was in a good place. I was having full-time writing, but I was not happy as a human being because I was lacking some level of interaction. So I really believe I have this missionaire or preacher, if you will, but I really believe in that. And I need to have a level of interconnection. So I really love teaching with the undergrads, and we do workshops, and I even put my stuff on the program, but I just put at the end. So most of the time I squeeze at the end of week 13 or week 12, and then we just say okay. And if they really want, we read. Yeah? But when I put that by missionaire and by someone who really believes in this level of interaction, what I mean by that is that this is nourishing me. So I'm not, if I were just saying I'm a real serious writer, so these people are taking my time or my energy, I will not be in the good shape, right? Mm-hmm. But I have this that has come to my format, my mind. I really believe that it's my religious or my spiritual duty to also have some interaction. And I really take seriously, I don't really involved in administration, I don't know my dean and my provost, I don't see those people, but my 12 students that I have in the classroom, in my creative writing, those are my public and my audience. And we try to do some marquetry, we read, and and I guess by the end, what we can do is that you can teach how to read. You cannot teach how to write or be some genius in writing. They write, because writing is a long process. It's a long run business, so you cannot do that in even 3 semesters. It's something that you can, it's some seeds that you can give them, and then they can maybe produce that afterwards. But in the process of writing, you can do what I call, I say to my classes, that is my strategy, and say, we have to build together the syllabus, it's a co-production, or I use the language of mixage or montage, and say the whole class have to be mixed every week. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they don't tell me, where is the devoir, and so where is the reading amount, and the requirement. I say, yeah, but let's do it differently, and mix everything and remix everything. But I really believe, and I need that, as a human being, I need this level of engagement, so that's why I'm, let's say, happy with this kind of classes. If I were directing PhD, I would be, I guess, in a different mood.
Yeah. Well, I hope your dean isn't watching.
I don't know.
This is being recorded.
We don't have grad school in GW, so it's okay. PC, you say here?
What about being in the US? One of the things that has been said is that in many ways, the US or the US university system has been the salvation of Francophone literature. That is, writing in French outside of France doesn't have the same kind of prestige and the same kind of place in France because of all kinds of difficulties within the sort of French literary and cultural milieu, whereas the US and US universities have been incredibly open to writers from outside of France, particularly. I mean, we had Assia Djebat at NYU, Edouard Glissant at CUNY, Marie Condé at Columbia, Alain Maboncourt in California, and you at NYU. Mm-hmm. So what is your experience of this, and what do you think of this this reality, in fact, that Francophone, or maybe French literature, or writing in French is alive and well in the US?
Yeah, lucky for us.
Or because of the US.
Yeah, good for us. No, the first thing that I was also, as you said previously, a teacher, so I was teaching in Education Nationale for 12 years in Normandy. So the first thing is that, yeah, this is really good. I mean, the academia as such. Maybe the two terms that will come quickly to my mind is flexibility and autonomy. The fact that we, because coming from the old French system where you have, you know, if you want to have a piece of shock, you have to ask someone, eventually you will have to ask to the minister. And here, you know, when you are hired by a group of, you know, maybe five person, you know, so this level of interaction is very new, it's very interesting, it's very definitely changing, sea change. The other thing is that the autonomy, you know, you can they allow you to experience, as I said, I experience my classes, as long as the students are happy, everyone is happy, so which is a clever way also. Whereas when I was in Normandy, you know, even my proviseur used to say, you know, Monsieur Waberi, you are also a teacher, you are also a writer, can you put something together and have an afternoon? And then you say, okay, well, we'll do with the people, the folk in the lycée, and then to just put two, three people together was a heck of, you know, because they say, okay, I'm not free here, I'm not available. So it was here you can experience, and everything is autonomous, everything is functioning at the level of the department and even a unit within the department. So that is rewarding. And the other thing is that also we have a public, I mean the audience, the students, who are so diverse, who are also so, they know how to, you know, they're autonomous also because they're used to that way. They are not relying on what is someone says, or what is on the program, and what is, you know, the baccalaureate. So every class is different. Every student is different. So you have to tailor the requirement for almost each and every one. So that is also, for me as a teacher and someone who believes in interaction, it's something that is definitely rewarding. Sometimes exhausting, but definitely rewarding. And for me, as I said, I believe in interaction. When I have a class of 12 students, it's 12 lives in front of me, les vivants, you know, with the life going on right now. So that is for me something that I can indulge in and fight with and be inspired by. Whereas in when I was teaching in a high school or in a university in France, they are in a program. So they are what I call captive audience, right? They're just here because it's on the program, because someone says somewhere, somehow, some years ago, they are not lively. Whereas in the US, you feel that you have chosen. You say, Monsieur Dash, I have chosen your class because you're teaching IT and so on and so forth. And so it's different changing. Coming now to the Francophone world, how it changed writers, of course. But it's not only Francophone world. It changed the whole pensée française, you know? Because you have Michel Serre in Stanford. You used to have Henri Girard. You used to have all the kind of striving people, inspiring people have somehow spent some time in the American academia.
Okay, and maybe we should have some questions from the audience as well. But let me ask you the question which you don't want to hear. How do you define yourself? What kind of writer? Because, you know, you're of the generation now which can easily say, to hell with that, I'm just a writer. Yeah. How do you define yourself?
You know, actually, I think that there is a Sufi thinking that says that the whole human being, you know, I can't remember, even it's in the Hadith, in the Quran also, is that you die every time and you realize them. So we are a constant process of renewing ourselves, rejuvenating. And this is not also just, you know, some kind of, how do you say, spiritual, moody, you know, nebulous thinking. Science says that, you know, our cells renew every 24 hours. And so every 24 hours we die and we began a new life. So if you ask me the guy, the Waberi of this time, and say he's some happy, blessed writer who is involved with the reading, and he's now in New York, you know? So I'm just by meaning that, but because when you say I'm Francophone, yes, but yet I'm also African, I'm also Djibouti, I'm also Somali, because part of my language, my mother tongue is language, is Somali, sorry. So some of my writing has to do with the tradition of poetry in that language. I'm also, even if not, I would say I come from the culture of Islam. Mm. So coming from the culture of Islam, I also have, and aging now, I also have interest in all kinds of, you know, Islamic philosophy, Buddhism, and so on and so forth. So I'm renewing myself, and the only fact that someone freeze my image and say it's Francophone, or you know, I'm not happy with that, because I want to keep alive and to keep changing and evolving every hour, yeah. Every 24 hours.
Right. So maybe we should have a couple questions. So the freshly reborn Abdourahman.
One of the refreshing attributes is to find an honest voice in a writer, because so many writers lack sincerity and authenticity and are just self-indulgent and narcissistic and artificial. So how do you encourage your students to find an honest voice?
Yeah, that is difficult, you know. I just say keep trying is a whole process of, you know, we are, I mean, I cannot even say to them that even your questioning might be addressed to me and say how you keep authentic and lively and so myself. So I just keep trying every 24 hours and just say, you know, one day at a time I will be a better person, you know. I as I was saying about Sufism, I was also reading many things about, I mean, many essays from Lemir Abdelkader, who's a great philosopher from Algeria, who was also a freedom fighter, and Lemir Abdelkader, or the poet from Pakistan, you know,
Iqbal,
you know, this kind of poetry. They're just saying that, yeah, keep trying, because it's humanism, you know, it's what we call it in the lightning, you know, the fact that being a human being is not a given. It's not something that is given for once. It's something, it's a bettering, if you will. You know, you have to strive being a better, become an insan kamil, as they say, you know, become a non-et homme in the 18th century, you know. Become a good human being, it's a whole process. You know, just keep it trying, one day at a time, 1 hour at a time, one meeting at a time. This is my only advice I can give them.
Can you explain
écrire en kilomètre, yeah. This is when I'm, for example, when I don't have a subject, you know, and because I don't decide I will write a poetry or I will write a short story book, I just write au kilomètre. It just means that I just keep writing, you know, I have an idea or have a desire or a fantasy, and I write for some time, you know, it can be weeks, it can be, because if the idea is not well sustained, it can just flop out, you know. I keep writing with a fantasy. Maybe I want to write some. It can be a vignette, you know. It can be inspired by an image, by something. So I just write for a while, and then I don't decide what will outcome of that. That what I call, there is no intention. Just write the process of writing, and then sometimes maybe Le Monde will ask me to a commission paper. And then something that I wrote in Gabon, and I was not knowing why I was writing this, it was an exercise of kilometer. So I will take that material, and then I reshape and carve for the paper that Le Monde asked me. You know what I mean? So it's a desire to write without intention.
Yeah, I remember once a similar kind of question was asked of Derek Walcott. He says, I don't get up in the morning and say, I feel a sonnet coming. Let's go ahead.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Hello. Yeah. Hello.
It's a wonderful practice. Now that you are immersed in a more non-francophonic setting, mm-hmm. in the U.S., given what you said earlier about certain words, come to your mm-hmm. imagination, mm-hmm. hold on to it. Mm-hmm. Are there certain American or English words that that the buzz in your head that you are trying to figure out what to do with? I'm just curious.
Yeah, it's fantastic. It's a fantastic question. In my latest book, I have a novel that is I call this is my American book, though it has to do with an African American musician who passed away some years now. His name is Scott Heron, Gil Scott Heron. So I,
yeah.
a kind of biography, really a fantasy biography about the life and fate and work of Gil Scott Heron, narrated from the point of view of his cat, which is a different story. But yeah, this is my American book. But still, to be honest, I don't think that the language I don't inhabit still in the English language, whether American or Jamaican or whatever, because I have not been raised in the lullabies, you know, because I think that I have to have an emotional connection with the language, so much so that I can just feel okay to write in an artistic way. So French is so far the only language that I have the notion of lullabies, what I call the musicality, in the ear, even the ear inside my ear, if you will. So still English is foreign to me from that point of view. I can write essays, academic essays in English, that is okay, but I cannot feel yet the language or the muscle of the language to just say I will do something. If I will go that way, maybe in a couple of years, I can write some poetry, maybe short poetry, like haikus. But I don't have the rhetoric of the language enough. For example, I have friends who are not even, they are Nigeria or Kenya. We know that every language has its own logic, its own economy. For example, the novel coming from the French or Francophone are thinner, and the Anglophone or English book are 25% thicker. It has to do with the economy of the language.
So this proof is also.
Yeah, Bruce is an exception. But let's say in nowadays, you know, if you just take someone from Africa writing French and someone from India writing or whatever, you know, the language, if you, from the time you move from French to English, you have 25% surplus. So it has to do, to my knowledge, to my understanding, the economy of the language. What we call in sen in French is not what we call in. In French, you can be elliptical. So sometimes when I'm being unnice to my friend, I say, your language has not invented the uses of ellipses. Because in English, you have to plant more extensively the setting, you know? So I don't have this logic, and I cannot feel quite at ease navigating in English yet. But maybe I will write something in poetry or some try, but I can still, and the other things that I'm, that is a question that is coming again, is that I cannot write in Somali, which is my native tongue, but I have not been schooled in Somali, which is also normal. So I'm in French, and I say there is no proud and no ni fierté, ni guilt. You know, I'm just a French writer in French, someone writing in French of this time and day.
Nice. Yes, hello.
Hello.
thank you for your work and your presence.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Say that to you. You kind of answered the question I was going to pose, whether you were ever thinking of writing in Somali, mm-hmm. but I'll nuance it as, mm-hmm. And add another question to it. And that's, are you in touch with, you know, say the Anglophone writers in Somaliland or the Somali writers in Somali? Is there any kind of reach across the linguistic borders to, you know, find some kind of, you know, diverse regional sort of literature and wherever, you know, that come from not only there but also the Horn of Africa? And secondly, since you're in America now, I'm wondering if you'll ever wind up treating the fact that Djibouti is on the front lines of the American, war of terror, in quotes, and, you know, the base being there, and what kind of effects that might have on your society?
Mm-hmm. Actually, maybe I will begin with the second section of the question. John Kerry, Secretary of State John Kerry, was a week, no, 2 days, 3 days ago in Djibouti for the first time. Mm-hmm. And so it's also difficult for me because we position, as you may have understood from the other side, I'm somehow Djiboutian authorities describe me as a nasty activist. And I don't think I'm even nasty and even an activist. I just say what I have to say because I'm used to that way. Mm-hmm. But I have this lack of not being living in the dictatorship and not have forgotten how to behave in a dictatorship. Mm-hmm. Because in a dictatorship, there is a way to behave, you know. Mm-hmm. You don't voice out your thinking. You don't voice out your criticism and so on and so forth. Me, I'm still a nasty boy, so I just voice out whatever comes into my mind. And I have a difficult relationship with the authorities. And coming now, we were used to be the French bases. It was in our DNA, kind of, because Djibouti was created as a military outpost, etc. Now, because of the war on terror, Americans also have a big base, the biggest in Africa. Mm-hmm. Japan has a Navy base, and German, and I can't remember, even Italian have something. So we became the place where you have a piece of land, and then you say, you show your militaristic muscles. You know? So and this is very heartbreaking for me, because we are stuck between the local dictatorship mm-hmm. and global militarism. And the way the war is going to be the next, I don't know, 10 years, is not very optimistic. So my dictator is using this leverage, because the French pay, the American pay, the Canadian pay, the Japanese pay, and so on and so forth, and reinforcing his own power. And he now is running for the fourth time president. We are small group saying, I mean, many people saying no. But we are not connected. We are not. We don't have the muscle to reach out to explain to the world, to say to Mr. Kerry, you know, Mr. Kerry, you are a gentleman. You know, this guy is not a gentleman. So this kind of stuff. I don't know if he's a gentleman now, but there's another question. Yeah. But anyhow, that's for me heartbreaking, because we are now global militarism and local dictatorship. Coming to the language, the question of relationship within the Horn. Yes, we have certain relationship. The irony is that everything now is also taking place outside. Mm-hmm. I mean, for example, Minneapolis became yes. a Somali literary scene. I have very close relationship with Nuruddin Farah, who is the most known writer. Actually, I wrote some years ago also some critical work on him. So we have close relationship at this level. But I would say that the most interesting voices, you have a cluster of young women writing from Somali experience. And so Somali experience is now becoming global, because you can have someone who used to be called Somaliland, who's now living in Australia, writing in English. You can have someone who is in Belgium writing in Dutch, for example. So we became globalized, like Haiti. Mm-hmm. And so there is a conversation that is going between Somali speaking people or Somali descent people. But all this conversation is going on in Dubai and elsewhere. But all this conversation is going outside. Because, as I said, in Djibouti, if you were having a colloquium in Djibouti, you have been utilized by the local dictatorship. So the discussion, the most interesting part of the discussion, is taking place in places like St. Paul, Minnesota. Mm-hmm. St. Paul, Minneapolis, Minnesota, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, we are almost at the end. We have one last question. Yeah. Okay.
You wording very well. Go ahead, okay.
It's just c'est la première fois qu'on se rencontre. Je suis du même, on vient du même pays. Et il y a 4-5 ans, j'ai écrit ma première
okay.
short story.
So this is the first time that we're meeting. Shukri and I, we came from the same country. And she has been involved writing.
Yes, I know. I just want to talk about a story that I wrote. The first short story that I wrote was about Askar Khan.
Okay.
un fou qui nous chassait quand on allait à l'école. Et je m'étais assise et j'ai fini l'histoire. Et quand j'ai fini et j'étais vraiment fière de mon histoire, j'ai lu juste une semaine après. La même histoire que vous avez écrite à propos de Askar Khan. Et j'ai été vraiment. Je ne vous connaissais pas, mais comment ça se fait que ce fou m'a inspiré et vous a inspiré? Et j'aimerais que vous parliez un peu de cette histoire, si vous vous rappelez.
Ok.
Monsieur.
Okay, she basically saying that she was involved in writing a story, her also from Djibouti, from her point of view. She was busy with her book, And she came across that with a character called Oscar Har, who mean is he was a tramp, a clochard, a bum. And she also knew the same guy, and she was busy writing the story on this guy. And then a week before, when she finished, she also came across that I also wrote from. I wrote about this guy, and so the question is, how you came across that we have, the same guy. So Oscar Har for me was when I was a kid. Maybe we were just schooling the same place, right? In my when I was 10, 12, 10, maybe I don't know. When I was in a elementary school, there was this guy who was close to my school, and we were coming out. It has to do with post-coloniality, because we were coming out of the school, and because of the dichotomy in the homestead, we speak Somali or Afar, and then in school we speak French. So we were kids, so we were just pumping on this guy, and we were asking questions in French, and say, you know how to multiply 9 by 7, and he would say in French. And I say, gosh, the subtext is my mother can say that, how this pump happened to know the French. And we were kids, so we were impressed by the command of language and some command of French culture by this guy, and we were not expecting that it comes from this guy, you know. And so I just, you know, it's a childhood memory, you know. When you are a child, you have been inspired by a couple of people, you know. You don't know why. It can be family or friends. So this guy was impressing in the photographic terms. You and I at the same time, because, you know.
You thank you. Good. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you. Merci. Merci.